Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
And thank you for being here. So it's going to be a journey with Suryaprakash's works, his life, his experiences. I would like to quote Nietzsche, Friedrich Wilhelm Nietzsche, who says that art and nothing but art. It's a great means of progress to life. It's a seduction to life and a stimulation of life. There is seduction, there is stimulation for Suryaprakash, you know, in the life itself, to which I would also add his passion, his intentions, and his committedness to his artistic expressions. He is one of those very well-established national artists, and he comes from the region of Andhra Pradesh. Yesterday, as I had mentioned, I don't know how many of you were there, that you know we need to contextualize an artist like Suryaprakash, particularly in the 1960s. That is when you know he started his career. He passed out in 1960. He came from a small village in near Hyderabad, and then he graduated as a fine arts student in 1960, and then you know his journey begins. So when he begins his journey, it is in that very crucial decade of the 1960s. The post-independence period, or rather the post-colonial period, because we had just got out of the colonial regime. Post-colonial period always has to do with Indian artists establishing their authenticity and identity from the margins of the third world to interact into the creatively into internationalism as it was known as then in the 60s. Today we call it as globalization, whatever it is. At that time it was internationalism. So, you know, it becomes very important because while the artists were trying to, you know, research their tradition and go back to tradition, here was one artist, you know, who was aware of this Indian artist, you know, identity crisis, but emotionally he was not engaged with such an idea. So he had to find a visual language, you know, that could communicate his expression. He was more concerned with that. So his agenda was, you know, to search for a visual language. So he was not a post-colonial artist, as you know, you would classify many other artists, but he was a post-modern artist because, you know, he appropriated quite a few styles from Western European masters like Impressionism, Post-Impressionism, Cubism, Expressionism, Surrealism. And this is very, very important. So in 1960s, when he begins his career, for a short time he was also in Delhi, where he apprenticed under Ram. It looks like from the beginning, Suryaprakash was very much interested in taking only what is essentially there in nature or in the world around. So he had a very abstract bent of mind. Now if you look at, these are his earliest works, 1965, you know, when he, 1960s rather, when he started, 61, 62, he did whatever he saw around him, his perceptual reality, his empirical experiences. When I say empirical experiences, it's something which he had experienced, witnessed, and then how he translates it. So he saw a lot of this construction of buildings. Then when he lived in Delhi, he saw, you know, the house tops, the rooftops all dumped with the various rubbish. And he saw these cables, you know, hanging, which is such a character of Delhi itself in its crowded areas. These things fascinated him, and then how he simplified it. So that is what is most important about it. That from the beginning, you know, he had this, you know, eye towards taking only what was essential in life, in reality around him, and then quickly. Now, this is a construction site. It is so cubist. Cubist in the sense that, you know, he takes only what is essentially required. And he gives the idea of a construction site. These are boats on the banks of the river, Jamuna. When he was in Delhi, he painted this. So everything is reduced, rather it is simplified. Then you know you see this one also, which are again boats, which it shows it in various other positions. And then this is another one, which are the rooftops, you know, which he saw. That's also another early work of his, which are the rooftops. Cezanne, it was Cezanne, you know, which captivated his imagination. I hope you're familiar with the names I'm taking. Cezanne was a post-impressionist artist. And it is he, you know, who completely changed the idea of how representation must be made. So he says, why should you look from one authoritative position? In a work of art, you look at the still life, if it is there, from various positions. You look at it from the side, you look at it from the back, you look at it from the top. So he created this arrangement of forms in space in such a way that the whole consistency of the surface was completely lost. There was no depth. You're not looking into the painting, you're constantly looking at the painting. So that is what captivated his imagination, and that is what he brought into his works. Then he was equally inspired by Indian abstract artists like Ram Kumar, Razak, Tayyar Mehta, Akbar Panansi, who had basically this, you know, abstract thinking itself. So from the beginning, you know, he had this predilection towards abstraction. And he says, I'm not an abstract artist, but I paint all those things which are abstract in nature. So that is where one needs to make a distinction between what is basically his abstraction. So you will look at his work and say, how can you call this as an abstraction? Well, it is an abstraction which he has taken from nature, reduced it to that simplified forms, and he has presented it. So, you know, this is his earliest journey, learning the ropes, you know, as I have called it. And you can see it there also. That's an electric pole, the lamp, I think. Now, you know, all these works were actually lost. These are all digital prints. He stayed in Delhi for some time, and then he comes back to Hyderabad. And he used to shuttle between, you know, the old city and the new part, wherever he lived. So one day when he was going through it, he saw on the footpath an entire junk of automobiles. And it just fascinated him. For him, it was visually exciting and also stunning. So when he looked at that, he used to take photographs. And then he never believed in any coins. You know, that was his perception, and that was his intelligence. In this is something dead, but it brings it to life. So what is inorganic has been made organic. So that's the duality. Somehow it is there throughout in his work. It is, you know, at the very heart of his artistic practice to have this kind of a duality where he's always, you know, reversing the roles. I think he's making it as inorganic into organic, organic into inorganic. And, you know, the parallel streams are always running there. But, you know, how he combines tradition and modernity, physical and metaphysical, positive and negative. So these are all aspects, you know, which you will see it in his works. So this is the first series which he did in 1965. And he had the guts to paint something like this at a young age. He was hardly 25 or 26, you know, when he painted this. And to make it into a kind of an abstract which had a lot of movement, it was organic. Another thing you will notice in his works is, you know, the quality of light. There's always a quality of light, you know, which is manifest in his works. It seems to be, you know, coming from within. It's a very aggressive light. So the element of light plays a very important role. Line, element of line plays a very important role. Textures, you will find it in his works, which are very much here. And colors. He was a master manipulator as far as the colors were concerned. Not only the colors, but all its subtle tonalities and all the subtle nuances he knew exactly how to handle. It's because he had perfected the technique. His technique is something which is very, very important. So what you saw is very rigid, very structured. You see how, you know, the whole thing melts and it becomes more fluid in its form. And that is how he created this. So here you have, you know, the representation of his colors. You already see the beginning, the way he used the colors. How, you know, something which you saw it as a rigid structure with defined forms now is completely dismantled, it completely melts into something else. Then, you know, he extends this. He extends this idea of urban detritus into what is known as abstract surrealism. So now the forms are completely gone, but, you know, he still uses some of these and he creates these kinds of paintings. Now, what is surreality? Surreality is something which is above this reality. It is not metaphysicality, but it is a reality which is not here, but it is above that. So that is what we call it as super reality. Now, when you look at all this, there's a foreboding feeling. It doesn't make you feel comfortable. You are in a landscape where you feel, you know, that you are not going to be
you're not invited into these landscapes. And, you know, that's the way he has created this. Now, he has a method of painting also, so you find this extending here. Many of the surrealist artists did paint in such a way. He was influenced by them. Always remember, every artist has his source of inspiration. But how he assimilates that, this is the way he has assimilated it. What is his point of reference to reality? It is the automobile. That automobile, how he now completely abstracts it. It is completely abstracted, and then this is the way he paints. Now, see, these are colors which doesn't beckon you. But at the same time, it's a warm color, whereby it is jumping towards you. And, you know, he uses this striking, discordant colors in his works, which again adds to that notion of, you know, surreality. So from here, you know, if you move on, there are many artists, of course, but you have to look at ancient vice, especially post-modernists. Because everything was happening in Delhi, or in Mumbai, or in Calcutta, just also nothing was happening in the 1960s, which led to an emergence of modernity in the South also. So similarly here, that is why, you know, when you look at his retrospective, why his early works of Suryaprakash are so important. When the form evolves. And he says, you know, how the form finally gets extended in various directions. And he says the tonalities that you see is his use of very soft brushes. He will use only one brush. He will use one color and then he will start working. Then he wants another color. There are many artists who will, you know, meticulously wipe off the whole brush and then use another color. He never does that. So he takes them, he just wipes it. And then, you know, he puts it in another color. And then when he applies it on the canvas, what happens? That residue paint which is already there in the brush mixes with the new paint which he, pigment which he has taken. And that is how, you know, you find these subtle tonalities, you know, which are very much there. Otherwise, it's impossible to mix 100, you know, like the Renaissance masters did, to mix only hundreds of these tones and then only keep applying. But this was his method. A method, you know, which allowed him to give this kind of a three-dimensional form. And at the same time, you know, these are all his surreal abstraction. So he comes to this kind of a surreal abstraction. See, that's another one. It looks like a loaf of meat, you know, which is placed on a... So, somehow you make a connection with the reality. And, you know, at this time when there was nobody to guide or to say, especially in Hyderabad, any great artist, he decided that he will depend on his perceptual and empirical experiences, as I told you. And then how these two come together, which allows him to develop various genres of painting and also establishes his versatility. And also claims for him a very significant position with his independent vision in this region of Hyderabad, being into inorganic. He doesn't specify whether it is particular species, botanical species that you are looking at. But it is generally and essentially a leaf that is being represented. And then, you know, he shows his, again, a very barren landscape. Now, these barren landscapes that you see here are all his experiences of having traveled in North India, in the Himalayas, you know, where he saw without any vegetation. I told you he is a perceptual artist. Perception is something of a very cognizant intellectual act. You don't say, I feel like it and I felt like it. But, you know, you have seen it and then you have interpreted that according to your experiences. And so when he has looked at these are internalized within him. These are very much internalized within him. And so, you know, as he works, all of these landscapes also come into being. So you see this here, levitational form, where you see autumn leaves. But here, you know, he gives it a very lush background. He gives a lush landscape here. Again, you see the same person which are floating in the air. This is a very beautiful work. It's completely in tonalities of yellows and oranges. And you know, when you have to handle just a single color with its tones, etc., it's quite difficult. But here, you know, he has managed to do it so well. You can, you know, see the entire range from the oranges to the browns to the yellow, oranges to the yellows to the browns and the deeper browns. You know, as he has represented it. See this one again here. So by abstraction. You understand? The form itself lends to creating an abstract work. So it's not abstraction in the sense of abstraction that you see only, you know, salad of brush strokes on the canvas and colors, etc. But this is precisely, you know, what he means by, I'm not an abstract artist, but I paint forms that are abstract in nature. And he says, I have no imagination. But you think an artist who has no imagination can paint like this? So that is where, you know, it's the simplicity of vision. It is the power of simplicity rather than the complexity of any thought or thinking or any philosophy. And to, you know, bring it down to this level, an artist really has to work through in order to come and, you know, represent what he has represented. And it has been a process for him. Not that, you know, and he's done a number of works. Here you see only a few representative works. That is a reflection series. See, as we started working, suddenly realized that he did not want any forms to be there at all. And he felt that it has to be just pure reflection. So, you know, he created these works. Can you see these works? The entire series, water reflection. And can you see these white dots? That is what tells you that this is a water surface. And, you know, whatever he has observed so far, he doesn't want to concretize any forms. But he, you know, uses it purely as colors. He uses it purely as colors. So here you have a full tonalities of blues. You have the tonalities of browns. Aren't they beautiful blues? Are you able to react to it? There's a lot of, you know, emotional empathy that you will. And again here, you know, you have these brown tonalities, which you can see it here. Now, so this was the reflection series. You know, where he says he will not have any kind of concretized forms. Then, you know, he begins to think about it and he visits Paris, National Gallery, London. And there he sees the works of Rodin and is inspired by the works of Rodin. So you can't, you know, lump him up and say, oh, it's an impressionist. Definitely not, it is not impressionist. What the impressionist did was something very different. They got the impressions of the light, of the climate, of, you know, various other ephemeral factors that they have caught. But what caught his imagination was a lotus and the lilies which Monet had represented. So, you know, he comes back, it is there, so it is subconscious, as I told you. And then he creates a circular pool in his garden. And then to that he adds the lotus pods. And suddenly these lotus pods, you know, begins to bloom. And, you know, they blossom with the lily pads, with the pads, etc. And they, you know, break the rim and they're all flowing out. And when he saw that, you know, it inspired him to create this series which is known as, which I call it as, defining the floral aesthetics. But he says even in an accident, there was a form. So, you know, you find him using palette knife, combining it with the brush. So, according to the needs, you know, of his composition, he also varied his tools. Prints somehow doesn't, you know, hasn't caught up. People don't want to buy prints, they say, oh, it's a print. But they don't know that it is done by an artist in a particular way, and it is very, very individualistic and very original also. See, these are his work. His work, and that is painting. These two, you know, the prints have it. See, that's the that's like a reflection. This is one of nature. This is beautiful. You can imagine what detailing he has done to, you know, get a work like that. It's absolutely, you can't say that it is done by hand. It looks like, you know, somebody has that harmony which is within him also gets reflected in his compositions. So here you see that, and this is three tone, which is used three colors. You may also begin to, you know, configure different kinds of, you know, water creatures also in it. His works doesn't say, look at me and go, he says, please come back. look at me again. You know, that's how his works are, because they are so detailed. And it is in this detailing, you know, that you really have to admire the artist. How he recreates, you know, the various forms which are there in an abstract manner, in a very abstract manner. So that is what basically you see. You will see stalks, you will see, you know, leaves, or you will see a variety here. The hibiscus is very, very prominent. And you know how he works here? If he has to do this, he will finish this. These are all his oils, by the way. These are all his oils. He'll finish this. Once it is finished, he'll move on to the next area. After that, he will never come back and touch this. No oil allows that versatility and flexibility in reworking. But he'll never do it. That's his confidence, that it is finished. And then that's how, you know, he goes along doing the whole composition. So this is a rhomboid. Within that, he has inscribed the serpent, which is that of a moon. And then, you know, he has recreated this. So this is how he creates this aesthetics of the floral world. Circular format. He just uses the circular format. Now comes the, his very important series, which is known as the bouquet to nature, which you will see as you that's her. Oh, what is there in this? Many have done it. Yes, they have done it. But look at the way he has done it. When you look at this, you cannot search anywhere in India. You can find a spot which is exactly like this. Because that is where, again, his originality comes in. He was not interested in taking a snapshot and then reproducing that in his canvas. Rather, you know, he would take a number of snapshots and take what is best from 10 snapshots and then put it together. So in a way, when you're looking at his works, they are a collage of his slices, of his memories that he has put together to create the landscape of the soul. And you know how he works? He works first with, you know, he just puts some tones as background. And then, you know, he put it on the ground. And then, you know, he'll begin to view at it from different. In some, the water body might just hit you. You know, in some, it may be going in some other direction. So that is what he basically does. So they are not snapshots, but you know how he recreates. That's what is important. How he recreates and reconfigures nature according to his sensibility. So that is what you see here. And, you know, some of them may be conscious use of brush strokes as blots, but otherwise he sprinkles. And in that sprinkling, again, he sees forms. And you know how many layers he works? If we go to about 10, 15 layers. That's why you see the depth. Any abstract work, when you see, for me, this is a total abstraction. It's an abstraction of nature, of its forms. And that is why, you know, you find that kind of a depth emerging because of those layers of, you know, the thin, transparent things that have been applied to it. This is, I think, one of his most wonderful works, but there are even more beautiful works on this side, isn't it? Okay, oh, nature, landscape, living. But then you see how he has worked at it. And that is important, and definitely they are very different. They are very different. And not many artists today will think of spending so much of time working with the technique. You know, the computer is there, the box is there, the whole virtual reality is there, the software is there, one click of a button and you have the whole world of you. But he continues to learn that. That is his commitment. That is his passion. That is his dedication. That is his work of art. And that is where, you know, an artist comes. He is able to establish that empathy with the viewers. When a work of art says, come closer, go back, look at me here, look at me there, is what is very, very important. It establishes that sense of communion. You know, it's an emotional communion which is established. I thought this was a marvelous work. See, without this kind of a background knowledge, you know, that compositional landscapes. Now, this is his very famous Venice series. Venice seems to have inspired him from a very young age. One of his teachers was with the Abhushan in the college. And, you know, he had gone to Venice, and they internalized it in him that one day he will go there and he will do it. And the opportunity came in 2012. Somebody, I think, sponsored, it was a residency of some sort. So he spent a 1 month in Venice. And here, you know, he captured the sight, the sounds, everything, the smell, everything of Venice in his various photographs. And then, you know, he started painting exactly like the way he would paint his landscapes. Now, if you go today to Venice, you will not find, you know, a alley, river alley, which will have these kind of buildings. But these are again arbitrarily chosen, selected, and put together to create a composition. When you look at the water, it looks like you're going to drown in that water. No, it has that kind of a depth. And you know what it does here, you have a play of contrast. You have a mass on one side, which is in terms of architecture, and then on the other side, you have the fluidity of the water. And you know, he contrasts that with this, again a duality, right? They are the opposites. And you know, he creates even the reflections. Now see this one here, how he creates the reflection. And it is said in Venice, the light is amazing. If you heard of Turner, William Turner, English painter, he went to Venice and he completely changed his idea of what an element of light and water can do in a work of art. You know what Turner did? Turner made his oil paintings into watercolors. He used such thin, transparent layers. He also invented his own technique, which is known as tumbling, you know, using a lot of white. And then, you know, creating the effect of this clouds getting reflected in the water. Turner was more interested in the elements, you know, fire, water, light, etc. Whereas, you know, if you're looking at Constable, he was more interested in being able to capture these two elements of light and its reflections in the water. And how that reflection, you know, also was a graphic artist. You know, he had a lot of interest because of his interest in light. So he wanted to do a lot of graphic work, so he did etching, he did interior prints, he did drawings, you know, using metallic paint with those gold and silver color.